take your Bibles out. Go with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 5. As you're turning over there, I want to tell you my notes are on the website. You can go to thebend.church/notes, and you'll find my notes there. I need your prayers. In the morning, I'm going to Nashville, Tennessee, Brentwood, to meet with our architects to get our plans underway so that we can get our building program underway. As you know, we've been given permission to go ahead and start building, and we think we have a great plan, and everything is getting ready to progress very quickly. And I talked with our architects today on the phone, and they're saying that they think they can get this done just in no time at all because of the style of building that we're doing. And so I hope to be able to come back to you next Sunday or this coming Sunday and give you a report with that and a time frame of how long it'll take us. Once those plans are done, that'll be taken to civil engineering. Civil engineering will not take long at all. We'll pull the permits and we'll start pushing dirt and doing the will of God out there on that property. So it's been a long couple of days and with us working on things, but God is about to get it happening out there. And so anyway, y'all be praying. How many's going to pray for me in the morning? 9 a.m. pray, right? That God will give us wisdom. All right, let's ask the Holy Spirit to help us tonight. We're going to talk about understanding the gifts of the Holy Ghost. Understanding the gifts of the Holy Ghost. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the Word of God. I thank you that the Word of God is true. I thank you that the Word of God is powerful. I thank you that the Word of God is the final authority and the ruler of all of our faith. I thank you, Lord, that you're going to speak tonight through your Word. You're going to change us. You're going to give us ears to hear what the Spirit of God has got to say to us tonight. And Lord, all of us tonight through revelation are going to be elevated and be able to be used at a greater level for your glory so that many souls will come to Christ and know you as Savior and Lord. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You know, wherever I go, I see Christians who are spiritually hungry and they really want to live a victorious Christian life. They really want to live an overcoming life in Christ, yet they remain powerless because they don't understand how to appropriate God's Word. It's one thing to know God's Word. It's another thing to know how to appropriate God's Word. In other words, to make the Word of God go to work for you and you go to work for it. And so I believe it's time for that to change, especially in the days in which we live. Now, just before Jesus Christ ascended into heaven, he made a promise. We've looked at this promise for months now. He said, "You shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you." Now, this promise of power comes as a result of the Holy Spirit visiting, impacting, infiltrating your life. The purpose of the power of the Holy Spirit is not some manifestation. Even though we're going to talk about these manifestations tonight, the purpose of the power of the Holy Ghost is to be a witness, to strengthen your Christian walk, to equip you in your Christian faith so that you can defeat the enemy and so that you can bring souls into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. We as a church do not believe that power is there to be demonstrated for power's sake. Power has a purpose. And Jesus said, "You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon you, and you shall be witnesses." Say that out loud with me, please. "And you shall be witnesses." You shall be. So how do you be a witness? How do you be a witness? Does that mean you run around to people and you carry a tract in your hand and you give that tract to them and tell them they're going to go to hell if they don't repent and turn of their sin? Is that how you are to be a witness? How are you to witness to the fact that Jesus is alive? Well, the answer to that is that our lives are empowered by the Holy Spirit, and the manifestations of the Spirit in and through our lives creates the witness that Jesus is alive. Now, before we get into the gifts of the Holy Spirit, I'm going to bring two scriptures to your attention. One of them is found in the book of Matthew chapter 5, verse number 6. Now, get ready. We're going to run here. Matthew chapter 5, verse number 6. Here's a key when it comes to everything in God. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Everything in God is predicated on hunger and thirst. If you're not hungry for God, if you're not thirsty for God, if there is not this desire in you for more of God, then you'll stop exactly where you are in your faith. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. Jesus said, they shall be filled. Who is the they? They who are hungry. Say that out loud. They who are hungry. Now, with that in mind, look at what Paul said as he began to talk about and teach about the gifts of the Holy Spirit in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse number 1. Pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. Now, 1 Corinthians chapter 12 is the list of the manifestations of the Holy Spirit. We know that there are 9 gifts, what you and I call gifts, but actually what the Bible calls manifestations of the Holy Spirit, 9. Those 9 manifestations listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 all have to flow through the birth canal of love. The motive of the manifestation of any gift is love. If it does not come out of a place of love, it is not the Holy Ghost. It is another spirit. So that's the reason in between 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the list of the 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit, and 1 Corinthians chapter 14, how those gifts are to work in the local church, he hinges those two things on the love factor in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. So everything that we do by the Spirit must be motivated and flow through the birth canal of love. Is everybody with me on that, right? It does no good to have... Listen, I'm going to say it like this. Some of the meanest Christians I know are Spirit-filled people. Some of the backbitingest Christians I know are Spirit-filled people. Some of the most critical people I know, bitter people I know, are Spirit-filled people. The people that should have life in them and have it more abundantly, should have joy unspeakable and full of glory, they don't have it, and I'm going to tell you why. Because they think they can have power without love, and it can't work. Power without love is witchcraft. Because power without love is only demonstrated for the purpose of manipulation. If I execute power over you without the motive of love, I am only trying to manipulate you to get you to do something for my end or for my good. I just said a mouthful right there. So all powerful manifestations must flow through the birth canal of love. If not, everything will be out of order. Right? But what I want you to notice, Matthew chapter 5, verse 6, Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse number 1, pursue, love, desire, spiritual gifts. Both of these passages, there is this thing called hunger that is at the essence of it. Now listen to me tonight. Look at me. I can give you information about the manifestations of the Holy Spirit. But the one thing I have no control over tonight is your hunger. Your hunger. Right? That is something that you have to cultivate. Desire. Hunger. Which means you got to stir it up on the inside of you. You got to get to this place that you're not satisfied with what you think you know. Because the truth is, everybody in this room, I don't care if you've been in church all your life, knows very little about God. He is a big God, right? We've barely scratched the surface. So we have to become dissatisfied. Not necessarily dissatisfied. It's not the right word. We have to get to this place where hunger drives our life to know more of God, right? Here's the reason why. And if you're going to tweet anything, here's your tweetable moment that I say all the time. God is moving at the speed of hunger. God is moving at the speed of hunger. No hunger, God doesn't move. Little hunger, God moves a little. A lot of hunger, God moves a lot. God moves at the speed of hunger. Say it out loud. God moves at the speed of hunger. So no wonder Paul said, desire spiritual gifts. Pursue love, desire spiritual gifts. Blessed are the hungry and thirsty. Those that hunger and thirst after righteousness, they shall be filled. God moves at the speed of hunger. That's individually, that's corporately. God moves at the speed of hunger. It's the reason we can never stop contending for more of God. Never, right? Now, let me give you some important fundamentals when it comes to the manifestations or the gifts of the Holy Spirit, as some call it. You want to write these things down. Number one, these are fundamentals. These are fundamentals before we even get into the gifts. Number one, the Father desires that we understand spiritual gifts. The Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse number 1, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I don't want you to be ignorant. The Father, God, wants us to understand the manifestations and the gifts of the Holy Spirit. It is not a mystery. It's not supposed to be strange. People have made it strange. Religion has made it strange. Denominations have made it strange. But to God, it's not strange. And God wants us to understand the gifts of the Holy Spirit. However, I want you to remember, the devil's success is dependent on your ignorance. Right? There's going to be a lot of one-liners in this message tonight, I can already tell. The devil's success depends on your ignorance. My people, the Bible says, are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. See, when you understand something and you understand how to stir, you understand the gifts and you understand how to stir the gifts up in your life, you have power and you have authority over the enemy. Ignorance gives the devil a play day in your life, right? Ignorance is not an option. Do you know in the book of Acts that Peter stood up and said, God at one point winked at ignorance, but no longer? Do you look at me. Do you know on this side of the cross, God has no room for ignorance? It's what the Bible says. In Acts, God winked at ignorance at one time. He's not winking anymore. Why is that? Because we're not in the time of types and shadows and mysteries. We're not in the time of the Word of God concealed. We're in the light of the glorious cross. We're in the time of grace where revelation is revealed. God does not take ignorance as an excuse. You cannot listen, you're going to be, all of us are going to have a lot of things to be sorry for when we stand before the Lord. But one of the things I don't want to be sorry for is standing before Him saying, Lord, I was ignorant of this. And Him hold up the book and say, how were you ignorant? It was right there, black and white, red and white. How were you ignorant of it? The Father desires that we understand the spirit realm and how the gifts of the Spirit work. Number two, second fundamental we need to get is the Father has provided these gifts to profit His children. To profit His children. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse number 7 says, the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. Do you know why God gives the manifestation of the Spirit to the believer? So that your life is profitable. God wants you to be profitable, right? So, according to your Bible, it is not God's will that we lack in any spiritual gift. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 5 through 7, Paul talking to the Corinthians said, you come behind in no gift. That is the will of God for every single believer in this room, that you lack no understanding when it comes to spiritual gifts. All right? I can tell a couple of you still ain't with me on it. Let me go to the third fundamental. Maybe this will get you on board. Our Father wants us to pursue the gifts that He has provided. Again, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 31, covet earnestly the best gifts, for yet I show you a more excellent way. Listen to what Paul says, covet earnestly the best gifts. Did you know that there are some gifts that are better to you than others? Because all of us have different personalities, different ministries. We're going to see that in the scripture here in just a moment. And some gifts will be more profitable to you than other gifts. And Paul said it's okay to covet those gifts. That's what he's talking about here, right? I have always coveted the word of knowledge. I've always coveted the word of wisdom. And I've always coveted the gift of faith, those three specific gifts. I don't know why. These are the gifts that God's impressed upon me. The word of knowledge, we'll tell you what that is in just a moment. The word of wisdom and the gift of faith. And I have coveted it. I have went after those gifts. And I'm going to show you how God has rewarded me in just a moment for going after those gifts. So there's nothing wrong with pursuing or coveting the best gifts. All right? Now, let's dive into the gifts. Y'all ready to look at the gifts of the Holy Spirit? Man, I hate that some people didn't show up this evening, because this is going to be good stuff here. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, let's all turn there, verses 4 through 11. And on the screen, I'm going to have some words in bold just to bring some more emphasis to them. The emphasis is mine. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 4 through 11. There are, this is Paul writing about these gifts, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. There are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. Now, it sounds real complicated there, but let me break this down to you and tell you what he's talking about. There's diversities of gifts. We know that there's 9 gifts mentioned right here in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We're about to get into them. We know there's another group of giftings that's mentioned in Romans chapter 12, right? We know there's another group of giftings that's mentioned in Ephesians chapter 4. And he gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers for the perfecting of the saints for the work of the ministry. So there are different kinds of gifts, but it's the same Spirit that's flowing through everybody. That's what he says here. There's different ministries. In other words, in this room, not everybody's called to be a pastor. Not everybody's called to be an evangelist. Not everybody's called necessarily to be a bank teller or to be a doctor or to be a lawyer. All of us in this room have different ministries that God has put in our life. So what he's saying here is that there's diversities of gifts, and the reason we have all of these different gifts is because everybody has a different ministry, right? Everybody's called to do something. Then notice, he says there are diversities of activities, diversities of activities. In other words, there's all different kinds of ways, scenarios, places, and opportunities that you're going to have to manifest these gifts. But what he's wanting you to see here is it is the same Lord, it is the same God, it is the same Holy Spirit that is working through all of them, right? So watch this now. The apostle, the person who's called to be an apostle, cannot boast because he's called to be an apostle and you're not called to be an apostle. It's the same Holy Ghost that works in the gift of the apostle that also works the word of knowledge in the layperson, in the audience. So in other words, what God is saying here, and he's not saying that he doesn't have structures of authority, but what he's saying is the level ground is, the ground is level when it comes to the Holy Spirit using people. The Holy Spirit will use anybody who is born again and has the Holy Ghost living on the inside of him. Everybody is a candidate to be used by God, okay? So Paul, what Paul's doing here is in these first couple of verses is he's really trying to emphasize that this is for everybody, not just for some, but for everybody. Now look at verse number 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Of all. Okay? Look right here. If you have the manifestation of a gift, if God works in you in a gift and it does not profit people, it is not the Holy Ghost. And here's the reason I'm saying that, because I've known some people that will use a gift to tear down folks, to demean folks. That's not the Holy Ghost. That is not how the gifts of the Holy Spirit work. When the manifestations of the Holy Spirit come, they come to profit everybody. So if somebody in here had a tongue, an interpretation of tongue, it is so that everybody profits from it. When we had Prophet Buster or Prophet Gustavo, and he picked somebody up, and he just happened to pick them up, and he happened to call their name, and he happened to know something about their life, and he was prophesying about what God was going to do in their life. Do you know that that word of prophecy going forth is for the profit of all? And at that moment, if what he's saying to them is fitting what you're believing for, you have a right to say, while that's in the atmosphere, I want it too. It is for the profit of all. Okay, we'll get into more of that in a moment. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the Spirit, to another the gift of or the faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts, notice plural here, gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as He wills. Look right here. I hear people say this all the time. I want to correct you on it so that you don't say this. Well, I have the gift of healing. No, you don't. Well, I have the gift of prophecy. No, you don't. Well, I have the gift of working of miracles. No, you do not. Well, I have the gift of word of knowledge. No, you do not. The Bible is clear. These gifts or manifestations are the manifestations of the Holy Spirit. What are they? They're the manifestations of the Holy Spirit. These are His gifts. These are His gifts. And what He does is distributes them, the manifestation. He distributes the manifestation to you and through you, and you have the wonderful privilege to steward the manifestation. Right? So that means that you can resist Him. That means you can quench Him. That means you can stop it, or that means you can yield to it and be fully used in it. But don't get arrogant with it. You don't own any of the manifestations or the gifts of the Holy Spirit. None of them belong to you. They all belong to the Holy Spirit. Now, it might be true that God uses you in the gift of prophecy, or God uses you in the gifts of healing more than He uses you in other gifts. Do you know why that is? Because internally, you have coveted those gifts above other gifts. Now, I've seen this in my own life where I have coveted the word of knowledge and God would start working in me and giving me things about people's lives and I would know it. And people would say, well, are you a psychic? How did you know that? Well, I'm not a psychic, but God, I coveted that God would use me in that. Now, the reason, would anybody like to know why I coveted that? Because when I got saved, the first gift that I was ever saw or manifested, there was a prophet that came to our church who pulled my daddy up and gave him a word of knowledge and told him everything about his life. We were living in a hotel room, broke, nothing to our name. He told my dad exactly where we were, what kind of living situation we were in, and then gave him a word of what was going to happen to his life. And I watched it come to pass, and we went out of poverty into the blessing, all because the word of knowledge came forth. So when I saw that as a young man, I said, God, would you let me work in that? And I started praying. Every time I would pray, I would cover it earnestly. Lord, let me work in that. Then all of a sudden, God started working in me. It wasn't that the Holy Ghost couldn't use me in other gifts. It was that, and it wasn't that I have the gift of the word of knowledge. I don't have that gift. It's just that what I coveted, the Holy Spirit blessed me with. Again, blessed is he who hungers and thirsts after righteousness. He shall be filled. Desire earnestly the best gifts. Covet the gifts. So what I desired came to my life. It was like faith. I prayed about it. I desired it. It came to my life. Well, then when I got into pastoring, I realized I didn't know near as much as I thought I knew. I got into pastoring, and I realized that I was really ignorant about growing churches and organizations. So then I started coveting the word of wisdom, right? Because you can have all the knowledge in the world. I went to Bible college, got all the knowledge in the world. But if I didn't know how to make it work, which is what wisdom does, wisdom takes knowledge and puts it to work, knows how to make it work. So I started praying for the word of wisdom to come to me. Lo and behold, God started giving me wisdom keys and showing me how to build things. Well, that shouldn't shock anybody, because the book of Psalms says, by wisdom is a house built. Right? You don't build a house based on knowledge. You build a house by wisdom. By wisdom is a house built. Did you know that Jeff Gabbert is a builder? Jeff Gabbert can tell you you can go to contractor school. The contractor book will say, do it this way, and this way. And I'll guarantee you there are a lot of things that Jeff Gabbert does not do by the book. Now, I'm not saying he cuts corners. What I'm saying is he has learned through wisdom and the application of knowledge that there's a better way to do it that's more efficient, right? So I started getting that. And then, the next thing I know, after I started getting the gift of wisdom, working in my life, yielding to that, and God would start showing me things, then all of a sudden I'd have these visions to do certain ministries. Well, guess what that required? Faith. So now I'm going before God saying, oh God, give me the gift of faith. Give me the gift of faith, because I don't believe I can do that. So you're going to have to give me a gift that makes me believe I can do that. Whatever you desire is what I'm trying to get this to you. Whatever you desire is what's coming to your life when it comes to the things of the Spirit. So it's all right to be at certain places in your life and desire certain gifts. The Holy Spirit do it, but don't make any mistake about it. He divides to each one severally as he wills. Who do the gifts belong to? Who do the gifts belong to? The Holy Spirit. Very good. Y'all are a good Bible class, I tell you. Couldn't be in. All right, so now let's take a moment and let's look at the 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to help break this down and make this easy for you to understand by dividing them into 3 groups. We're only going to look at 1 group tonight. The revelation gifts. The revelation gifts. Well, what is the revelation gifts? The revelation gift is the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, and the discerning of spirits. Now, the reason we call these revelation gifts is because all of this information that the Holy Spirit gives you has to come via revelation. This is not based on any knowledge you already know. Not based on any knowledge you already know. This is all supernaturally given to you. So let's go into the revelation gifts. So we have revelation gifts. We have the vocal gifts. I'm sorry. Let me give you the 3 categories. The vocal gifts. Vocal gifts are tongues, interpretation of tongues, and prophecy. Then we have power gifts. The power gifts are faith, healings, and the working of miracles. Right? So we have revelation gifts, vocal gifts, power gifts. 3 different categories. And I'm going to say it like this. 3 dimensions of gifts. 3. Isn't that interesting? Notice how many times you see 3 repeated in the Bible. First the blade, then the ear, then the full corn in the ear. I write to you, children. I write to you, young men. This is 1 John. I write to you, fathers. Outer court, inner court, holy of holies. Right? This is all through the Word of God. So these gifts of the Holy Spirit, manifestations, are actually in various dimensions. And it takes various levels of the presence of God. And I say various levels, they're different manifestations, various levels of dimensions of the presence to God to operate in them. For example, can I explain what I'm trying to say here? Most Spirit-filled Christians in church can believe to operate in tongues and interpretation of tongues. Do you know why? Because that's the easiest of the 2 gifts to operate in. Because you talk all the time. So since you use your tongue every day, and if you're filled with the Holy Spirit and have the gift of tongues already working in your life, then the Spirit of God can move on you. You have faith. It's easy. You're already doing it. You yield to that easier. So that's the reason in most Pentecostal churches, about all you ever see is tongues and interpretation of tongues. And they think they have had some incredible move of the Holy Spirit as a result of it. But very rarely do you see the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, the gift of prophecy, or better yet, here's another dimension, the gift of faith, the working of miracles, and the gifts of healings. Different degrees of power, different degrees of demonstration. Right? So, it's very important for us to understand what we desire comes to our life, but also, just because we're desiring something, maybe we're not living in a level of the presence of God or the place in God that gives us access to those gifts to work in us yet. Selah. Just go home and think about it. The Lord will show it to you just like He did me. And by the way, I didn't make that up. It's actually in the book. Let me show it to you. Let's talk about the revelation gifts. Revelation gift, the word of wisdom. About half of y'all look like you don't even want to be here. Praise the Lord. I've got a good mind just to shut it down and go home. Word of wisdom. Word of wisdom. What is the word of wisdom? The word of wisdom, again, is the application of knowledge. What is this gift and how does it work? Well, you and I experience the word of wisdom when the Holy Spirit gives us supernatural wisdom or understanding through His word in certain situations. Certain situations. I'll give you an example in Jesus' life. When Jesus was faced with the temptation in the wilderness, He ignored what Satan attempted to offer Him, and He responded by quoting the word of God. Right? So, if you be the Son of God, cast yourself off this cliff, and the angels will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. Well, is it true He's the Son of God? Is it true that the angels would rescue Him if He needed rescuing? Absolutely, it's true. So, if He based what He was doing just on truth, you better listen to what I'm saying. Just because something true doesn't mean it's wise. If He based what He was doing based on truth, He would have violated a principle in God's word. But notice how Jesus responded. Thou shalt not tempt the Lord your God. He quoted a scripture. How did He know in that moment what to do? The word of wisdom via the Holy Spirit in His life, the word of wisdom came to Him and said, this is a moment of temptation. Now, compare that to Eve. Satan comes to Eve and basically quotes a portion, now he twisted a little bit, of the word of God to Eve. But Eve did not use the word of God to rebuke Satan. And therefore, Eve saw what she thought was true and took advantage of it. And just because it was true didn't mean it was wisdom. And it caused the fall. Everybody with me? So Jesus operating in the word of God. This is the reason, folks. Listen. You can be watching the news and they might be telling you the truth, but what they're saying might not be the wisdom of God. Right? You could go, I'm trying not to get too deep in this. I don't want to get as a ball lost in high weeds over nothing here. But it's so important for you to understand this. So, the word of wisdom is supernatural knowledge that comes to you in a certain situation and knowing what to do in that situation. Did you know that you can use the word of wisdom to defeat the purpose of the enemy by knowing how to apply the word? Now, there is something that is required to operate heavenly in this gift. A knowledge of the word of God. So, prayer, heavy prayer, is required to operate in the gift of discerning of spirits. A knowledge of the word of God is required to operate in the word of wisdom. So you can pray all you want, you can desire all you want, but if you don't fill your heart and mind with the word of God, you will never operate in the word of wisdom. Did everybody just hear what I heard what I just said? So you've got to spend time consuming the Word of God in order to operate in this. The Word of Wisdom is essential in the operation of all the other gifts. So listen to what I'm saying. If you're going to operate in all the other eight, you've got to operate in this one. So look at me. You can pray, you can desire to be used in the gifts of healing, but if you haven't consumed the Word of God where God can give you the Word of wisdom, you can't operate in it. You say, well, prove that to me. Okay, I'm glad you asked me that. Well, Jesus would walk up to one man who is blind and just simply lay his hands on him. But another blind man would come up and he would spit in dirt, rub it in his eyes, and tell him to go wash. How did he know what would work in each, or why didn't he just heal everybody the same? Because the Word of wisdom was working in him. Everybody looks at your neighbor and say, that's good stuff. I hope you listen to that. Okay, let's talk about the word of knowledge because I'm running out of time. The word of knowledge. The word of knowledge is the receiving of supernatural facts by the Holy Spirit. So the word of wisdom is the application of knowledge. Right? I look at Steve. I know Steve has a brace on his leg. And he doesn't, but this is hypothetical. Steve has a brace on his leg. I'm preaching. I'm looking at that brace. And all of a sudden, the Lord speaks to me and says, tell Steve, I'm going to heal his back. From the outward appearance, it looks like his problem is in his leg. But really, it's in his back. That's the word of wisdom. The word of knowledge would be me looking at the brace. And all of a sudden, there would be a knowing in me that says, this has nothing to do with his leg. This has to do with his back. 5 years ago, he was in an accident and he destroyed this vertebrae, and this vertebrae. And the Holy Ghost is giving me knowledge that I would not have any other way. I didn't study it. I didn't work it up. It is just the Holy Spirit giving me knowledge. Now, we looked at this scripture one time before and I hit it and ran, but I want to show you how the word of knowledge really works in the life of the believer. And I'm hoping that you will start yielding to this and learning how to work in this gift after I show you this scripture. It's found in the book of Hosea, chapter 12, verse number 10. Hosea, chapter 12, verse number 10. I have also spoken by the prophets, and I have multiplied visions and used similitudes, the King James says, the similitudes by the ministry of the prophets. What God's saying through his Hosea is he's giving you a key how he worked through the prophets. Right? He said, how I worked through the prophets is I gave them similitudes. Similitudes. What is a similitude? Well, in the Hebrew there, similitude means an impression. It's an impression. So, the word of knowledge, at least in my life, when it works through me, when God gives me supernatural facts, and I think everybody in this room, most everybody's been in the room, whenever God has given me a name or given me dates or something like that, that I had no clue about, you can't study that stuff up. It's just God gives it to you. People say, well, how do you know that? Well, I never heard a voice. It wasn't a voice in my head that said, hey, October or this. It wasn't a voice in my head. It was like just in here, I just knew, just had an impression. It's impossible for me to communicate this to you. This is more caught than taught. You just have an impression, right? That you just know certain things, right? And like, for example, we were sitting with this pastor in Texas, this Hispanic pastor, and the Lord just gave me this impression. I said, hey, I've just got this word. I got this impression that God is giving you land. He was talking to me about my land. I said, God is giving you land. And I said, I was believing for 4 acres, and now God has given us this much land. And I said, God is giving you land. He said, oh, my God, that's the most amazing thing. He said, this is the word of the Lord to me. It's confirmation to me. He said, we have a deal working right now on 4 acres in the middle of the city of Houston. But the reason that we're hanging up on it is because there's another 10 acres that's right beside it, and we're believing God for that building as well. And he said, and I said, is there a nonprofit who owns that organization? He said, yes. I said, I believe God's going to cause the nonprofit to give you that property. give you that property. He said, oh, that's got to be a word from the Lord. How did I know that? Did it come in my mind? No, it's just like I just knew. And I just, what I've done through the years, the Bible says, you have your senses exercised by reason of use. This is Galatians. Have your senses exercised by reason. So through the years, when I've got those impressions, I've just been bold enough to move on it. Now, when I first started out, I'd say, this is going to seem really weird, and maybe I'm totally off, but can I just ask you a question? Because I just have a sense of something, and tell me if I'm on or off. And what would happen is, people would say, how'd you know that? How'd you know that? Well, I just had an impression by the Lord. Felt like the Lord showed it to me, right? That's how it comes. Now listen to me. There's only one way to magnify that in your life. Prayer. Your desire to hear God's voice is the only way to magnify that in your life. It'll never come any other way. I'm telling you, you can go to 1,000 church services and you can have every prophet in America lay their hands on you and oil you down like a pig. You will never operate in that gift to the fullness of it until you spend time in prayer. Because it is in prayer is where you learn to hear the voice of God. Everybody tap your neighbor and say, pray. So this is the most important part. Now, there's numerous examples of the word of knowledge in Scripture. I'm not going to go through all of them. But let me give you one or two. Here's an example. It's in 2 Kings chapter 5. When Elisha the prophet knew that Gehazi had lied to Naaman the leper. How did he know that? The word of knowledge came. You say, well, that's the Old Testament. Does this gift work in the New Testament? Absolutely. Let me give you some examples. Ananias and Sapphira pretended to sell their land and to give it all to God's work, but when they walked into church and put the tithing check in the bucket, Peter said, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Ghost? How did Peter know that? The Holy Ghost told him. Let me give you one more example of this. Let's move on. I'm going to come back to all of these in deeper teaching. All right, let's go to the third one, discerning of spirits. I'm running out of time. I got 5 minutes on this one. Discerning of spirits. What is discerning of spirits? It is the perceiving of the source of a manifestation. Perceiving of the source of a manifestation. If you're taking notes, out beside discerning of spirits, write these words. It is not the gift of suspicion. A lot of suspicious people out there. The discerning of spirits is the ability to perceive the source of a manifestation. The last of the three revelation gifts helps you to perceive whether a spiritual manifestation is from, watch this, one of three sources: God, man, or the devil. There are some people, they just manifest, it's just people, people being people. It's just man stuff. There's other manifestations that's God. And then there's some things that come through people that's the devil. Again, how do you magnify the discerning of spirits? Prayer. Prayer is what makes you sensitive to the spirit realm. Prayer. And, let me say it, take it a step further, fasting. Fasting really amplifies your spirit man to the spirit realm. Okay? Now, let me give you an example. It was the discerning of spirits that helped the Apostle Peter understand the vision spoken of in Acts chapter 10 when God lowered the sheet down. And there's all kinds of unclean things on it. And Peter had never eaten any bacon in his life. And he said, oh, that's unclean. I can't eat it. And God said, don't call unclean what I have called clean. And then Peter spoke up and he said, of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. Immediately, Peter was going to rebuke God for the sheet. But then he realized this was a manifestation of God showing him truth about something that was to come concerning people. This is the discerning spirits. It was the gift of the discerning of spirits that led Paul to cast the evil spirit out of a fortune teller who seemingly spoke the truth. So here's this fortune teller running around behind Paul saying, oh, these are the power of God. These are men of God. These are prophets of God. Well, what she was saying was the truth. Now, in the modern day church, if somebody did that, everybody would clap and say, yes, sir. Right? But Peter knew this was of the devil. Now, watch. One time, he has the manifestation of a sheet coming down. It doesn't look like God, and it is God. And he perceives of a truth that God's talking about not being the respecter of persons. In another time, there's a woman running around sounding like she's from God, and he perceives it's the devil talking through her. See how important this right here is? I personally believe one of the greatest gifts that we need in the last days is the gifts of the discerning of the spirits. Right? So this is not the gift of suspicion. This is you being able to walk into an environment, or better yet, to see the manifestation on a person's life and say, that's God. That's just them being stupid. Or that's the devil. Right? Now, why is that important? Because if you know the source of the manifestation, you know how to do ministry. If it's the devil, you don't pray for it. You cast it out. You can't pray for a devil. He's not going to get better. You cast him out, right? If it's man, prayer won't do any good either. You have to disciple that out. You have to disciple behavior out. If it's God, you get on board with whatever God's doing, right? And you don't fight against him. If you don't have this gift operating in your life, you're going to miss a lot that God has for you. So, all of these gifts, and the biggest thing I want us to take away tonight, because I don't have time to go into the rest of them. We'll get the rest of them Sunday morning. Is that okay? Yes. The good ones are coming. I say the good ones. My favorite ones are on down the list. Who do the gifts belong to? And these aren't necessarily gifts. These are manifestations, which means you have been called to steward a manifestation of his presence. That's all it is. When we say people flowing in the gifts, they're stewarding a manifestation of the presence of God in their life. And it's different. And the Holy Ghost shows up in different ways, in different environments, through different gifts and manifestations, through different kinds of people. So don't put him in a box, right? Learn to be led of the Spirit of God. All right, let's stand up. I'm going to pray over you, and we're going to get out of here tonight. We have baptism, water baptism, Sunday morning, and we have quite a few people who are following the Lord in water baptism. Praise the Lord. So it's been awesome to see that over and over again here. So if you want to be water baptized and you have not yet been water baptized, you must be water baptized, right? I believe if you have really made a decision to follow Christ, you will really want to get in water. I really believe that. So if you haven't been water baptized, you want to be, see Pastor Steve, or you can let us know if you're watching on Facebook. We will water baptize you Sunday morning. Let me pray over you. In fact, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to let Steve come up here, and I'm going to let him pray over us tonight and just bless us as we go out. Anybody get anything out of the Word tonight? What speed does God move at? What speed does God move at?
Let's pray. Father, increase our hunger. Increase our desire to have these gifts, Father. And remind us constantly that they're not for us, they're for the profit of all. Yes, Father, we thank you for the gifts, the way you show us. And Father, I ask you tonight to help each and every one of us in here to gain that desire, that hunger for righteousness, that we might be filled. Father, I ask you to go with each person in here tonight. I ask you to touch them with a special portion this week as they go to their homes, as they go to their jobs, as they go to schools. May the light of love and the joy of Christ go before us everywhere we go, Father. May people know just by looking at us that something is different, that you might be glorified. May we walk in your favor and your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week.